Hey friends, welcome to my one-bedroom minimalist apartment. I embraced minimalism in early 2021, and since then, it has really shaped my day-to-day decisions and the way I go through life. If you're new to this channel, my name is Peter and I make videos about minimalism and slow living. As you will see, I'm not an extreme minimalist. I really admire them, but I don't live like a monk. I have a bed and a sofa. Oh, and I own 4 spoons. Yeah. Like all these minimalist apartment tours on YouTube, we'll start at the door. The hallway has a coat hanger. Right now, it holds my thick black winter coat, as well as a grey coat which I wear in spring and autumn. I really love this shoe rack. Before, I always struggled with my shoes in this tiny hallway. Now I can take a seat and take off my shoes comfortably. The living room is the best part of the apartment, with big windows that let in lots of natural daylight. This is really important to me. I once stayed in a hotel room in Vietnam that was literally a basement with no windows. It was very disorienting. In general, I found that lack of natural daylight at home really affects my mood. When you enter, there's a fireplace to the right. I've been told it works, but I have yet to try it. The living room is divided in 3 parts: the sitting area, the kitchen, and my desk. What I love about it is that it's very spacious. This made it easy to do workouts at home during the pandemic. The open space also creates headspace. When I moved into this apartment, it was already furnished. After a few years, I asked the landlord if it was okay to make some changes. It really didn't feel like home to me, especially the sitting area. So the landlord gave me the okay to replace the sofa, and I painted all the walls as well. But I also had to make compromises. When I first started with minimalism, I felt that my apartment doesn't have that typical minimalist style you find on Pinterest and in magazines. And I'm not gonna lie, it bothered me. I wanted that look. But over time, I've learned that minimalism isn't something you buy, it's something you do. It's about cutting the fat and changing your relationship to the things you own. Your stuff doesn't define you. Let's start with the sitting area. I got this 3-seater sofa from Jysk, a Danish retail chain. I really enjoy sitting here and looking out the window. It's not the most comfortable and sturdy sofa, but what I really love about it is that the chaise longue has storage underneath the seat. The lid automatically stops in the open position so that I can easily pick out things or put them back. This is where I store my rollers, yoga mat, as well as the gear I use to film these YouTube videos. Another thing that's great about this sofa is that it can be converted into a bed, which is great for guests or movie nights. In front of the sofa is a set of 2 Stockholm coffee tables with walnut veneer from IKEA. This hand-woven rug is also from IKEA. It's made from 100% wool, a natural and durable material. I like how it adds warmth and color to the living room and contrasts nicely with the stone tiles. For the same reason, I put a few throw pillows on the sofa. On the wall are 2 picture ledges. There's a little figurine of Totoro. If you haven't seen the Studio Ghibli movie My Neighbor Totoro, go check it out, it's one of my favorites. These 2 picture frames show 2 of my guiding principles in life. The word slow refers to the slow living lifestyle, which I'm inspired by. Slow living proponents argue that, as a society, we're addicted to speed and efficiency. I'm guilty of that too. So this word reminds me that I need to find moments to slow down, in order to not burn out. If you want to learn more about slow living, check out my video What is Slow Living on my channel. This too shall pass is a sentence I first heard at a Vipassana meditation retreat, when the late Asan Guenka told a story about a son who inherited a ring from his father with this inscription. It reminds me that nothing, good or bad, lasts forever. And these plants? They're fake. I know what you're thinking. Let me explain. I would love to have real plants one day. However, the reality is that because my girlfriend lives abroad, I'm often away for prolonged periods of time. Plants wouldn't survive, so I decided fake plants are the best alternative. I love reading. However, I don't have any physical books lying around. Instead, I read everything on my e-reader. Right now, I'm reading Digital Minimalism by Carl Newport. It's a great read. He writes that we didn't sign up for the digital world in which we're currently entrenched. The common response to counter the impact of our smartphones, of social media and email, is to suggest modest hacks and tips. However, Carl Newport argues that we need something more profound, a philosophy of technology use rooted in our deep values. I feel that after minimizing my apartment, digital minimalism is the natural next step to take. When I do, I will definitely share my experience in future videos, so subscribe to the channel for that. I don't have fancy things like smart color-changing light bulbs, and I don't use my ceiling lights much. During the day, the incoming daylight is often sufficient, and at night I prefer this lamp next to the sofa for its softer light. I have only one work of art in my entire apartment. This one is special to me because it was created by my dad, a very talented artist. Seeing this watercolor painting of a church in the Netherlands is a subtle way to connect with him. Next to the painting is the door to the balcony. Unfortunately, it's winter now, so I can't spend any time here. But when the weather allows it, I love sitting here and enjoy the view or read a book. The kitchen is where I prep and cook my food, make coffee, and do my laundry. As Mattia Vella said,
there's just something about the aesthetic of the laundry next to your food that says, you haven't quite made it yet.
Really, Matt? Ouch. The way the kitchen is set up, I can't put everything out of sight, but I try to make it as organized as possible. Oh wait, you weren't supposed to see that. I keep the kitchen counter as empty as possible, except for the kettle, which I use every day. The reason is that each item in our living space ends up on a silent to-do list. This is a concept popularized by Fumio Sasaki in his book Goodbye Things. The idea behind it is that each item has needs and wants to be cared for. It's like they take on a personality.
Hey, we're dirty. We've been here for hours. When are you going to clean us?
I did an entire video about this, which I will link to at the top right corner of your screen. The goal is not to have an empty silent to-do list, but having fewer objects greatly reduces the number of messages that are sent your way. It's a liberating feeling. Oh, and the fridge? That's in the corner, opposite of the kitchen. Which brings us to the pride and joy of my living room, my minimalist desk, where I'm editing this video right now. I turned the dining table into my desk and put the 6 chairs that came with it in storage. I now eat my meals either at the desk or on the sofa. My desk setup is really basic. There's this soft light table lamp to the left, and my 13-inch 2018 MacBook Pro on a roost stand to the right, and that is connected to an Asus ProArt 24.1-inch monitor, and I use a Magic Trackpad and Magic Keyboard to make it all work. Most of the time, I just use the monitor as a single screen and turn off the laptop screen. Except for specific situations, like when I'm taking notes while watching a video course. I don't have any external speakers, instead I use the Sony noise cancelling headphones. They're amazing, one of my best investments ever. I don't have an elegant cable solution yet. For now, I'm using this cable box, but this is something I'd like to improve in the future. The monitor also doubles as a TV for when I want to watch something on a screen that's bigger than my laptop. Most of the time, my laptop is sufficient enough though. In his book Willpower Doesn't Work, Benjamin Hardy writes, "The environment you're in should clearly match the behavior you're doing. It is for this reason that you shouldn't have a TV in your bedroom." I really believe in that advice, and if I had the space, I would have my desk in a separate office too. But in the bedroom, I follow it to a T. All I do here is sleep and get dressed. There are nightstands on both sides of the bed, a dresser and a closet. I honestly don't need that much space, but they came with the apartment, so I gotta keep them. I have a white noise machine next to my bed. I'm a light sleeper, and there's a barking dog that sometimes keeps me up at night. This white noise machine emulates the sound of a fan, and it helps blur out any other sounds. I've got some storage space underneath the bed, which is where the thick duvet goes when it's not winter. Then there's my mandatory minimalist t-shirts, cause hey, you can't be a minimalist without plain looking t-shirts. 4 of them, in the same color. This is the closet. The hangers are red. Don't ask. I just can't be bothered to replace them with fancier ones. The bedroom also has 2 mirrors. So if I feel I don't look minimalist enough in one, I can always get a second opinion. And this is the bathroom, with the shower to the right. The bathroom is small and basic. The toilet is on the left side, and the sink in the middle. Above and below is storage space for toiletries. Since I decluttered my apartment and took a more minimalist approach to life, I've noticed some profound changes. Minimalism grounds me. I have more headspace and I live with more intention. And I've also learned that minimalism is not a competition of who has the fewest possessions, but that it's about creating space for what's truly important. I told this story in my video, How Minimalism Changed My Life, which you can watch right here. It's one of the most popular videos on my channel. Hope to see you there. Bye!